Hello, today we are going to cover the topic on blending on raw frame. So let us first understand the difference between mixing and blending. Bringing together two or more fibers of same nature is known as mixing. That is, if cottons are brought from different regions and they are mixed together at any stage during processing, it is called as mixing. Bringing together two fibers of or more fibers of different nature is known as blending. For example, if you are going to mix polyester and cotton together, it is going to be called as blending. There's a special name. So with this background, let us see why blending is done, or what are the reasons for blending. For certain applications, a blend may be able to provide the required characteristics. For example, in a particular application, if I want certain properties of the yarn, then I may have to select the appropriate fiber to make a blend. Another reason for blending with man-made fibers may be because of high cost of natural fibers. It is seen that natural fibers are costlier than the man-made fibers, and so to bring down the cost, maybe sometimes man-made fibers are added. There is an increase in the consumption of natural fibers along with the limited production. Also, at the same time, natural fibers production is limited, and therefore, but naturally the cost rises. And for such reasons as to bring down the cost, we may have to blend with man-made fibers. Blends of different man-made fibers are also made. That means within the classification of man-made fibers, they may be blended with each other to get certain properties, and such blending is also on the rise. So now, once we have decided that we want to blend any two materials, then we should try to find out where exactly it would be beneficial for me to blend. There are two stages at which blending can happen. One is the blow room and the other one is the draw frame. There are two factors on which we can decide this fact that whether we want to blend on blow room or draw frame. The two factors that would decide would be the homogeneity of the blend and the blend proportion. Blending at blow room gives good blend homogeneity because there are a lot of machines that follow. There's a big line that follows after the blending stage in blow room, where more homogeneity can be expected. But what happens is it cannot guarantee the accuracy of the blend proportion. Suppose I want a particular blend proportion, say 67, 33 or 50-50, then during the processing we may lose more fibers of one component, and it might not ensure me an accurate blend. So blending at draw frame is more accurate in terms of blend proportion because we are going to feed slivers in a particular ratio. And it will ensure, because there is no waste or trash removed like blow room. So blend proportion is slightly more better accurate, but the blend homogeneity might get affected because there's not a lot of opening and opening or cleaning that's happening here just like blow room. So it's possible that the slivers that we blend might remain as strips of thinner sliver in the yarn. So you might not find homogeneity if you have not used certain methods to see that homogeneity is improved. So therefore, when maintaining the blend proportion is more important. Suppose for a particular application, I need that the blend proportion should be accurate, then but natural I will select a draw frame stage for blending. Whereas if there is a situation where each component, my two components are there, then they widely vary in their properties, like for example trash content, then I would require a separate cleaning line for both of them. And in that case, I would not be able to blend it in blow room. I will have to first separately process them in blow room and card, and then do the blending at draw frame. The same goes for different sensitivities. Suppose there are two fibers which are sensitive to damage, then I cannot use the same process or the same settings in blow room, and therefore then again I will have to select draw frame as a stage for blending. So homogeneity and blend proportion at draw frame two passages are used normally, and sometimes even three passages are used, one for blending and the remaining two after that, to give a satisfactory blend homogeneity. Draw frame is normally used for binary or two component blend. The required blend can be obtained by adjusting the following two parameters. One is the linear density, which is the Hank or kilotex of each sliver, and the number of slivers of each component. If I were to change any one of them, the blend component, the blending proportion of these two components could be changed. It might be noted that for uniform grip on all fibers during drafting, they must be of the similar bulk or volume characteristics. If they are different with respect to bulk, then they shall not be uniformly gripped by the drafting rollers, leading to irregularities in the delivered sliver. So component feed slivers shall be equally in volume only if the component fibers have equal densities. So to reinforce the earlier point that the volume of the slivers should be similar, otherwise it won't be gripped properly. So one should see to it that the fibers are of equal density. If they are not of equal density, the volume will change, the bulk will change, and therefore they will not be gripped properly by the drafting rollers. For an equal linear density of feed sliver, suppose I have two slivers of equal linear densities, then the volume occupied by a given length of sliver would be more for a fiber of lower density. So if there are two slivers and one has got lower density, then that particular sliver will be more bulkier in nature as compared to the other one. So let us try and understand this with the help of an example. If we compare two slivers of cotton and polyester of linear density, say 5, there are two slivers, one made of cotton, another made of polyester, but and both are of equal linear density. That means there is no change in Hank or count of the sliver. But only difference is that they are made of cotton and polyester. So how does it work? What is the volume that you can expect for these two components? And another third component is also given just for comparison, and that's acrylic, which is supposed to be the most bulkiest material. So volume of cotton, say for 1000 meters of length of sliver, because we are taking 1000 meters because we know the definition of 5 ktex, that is it's a weight in kgs of 1000 meters of material. So if I take 1000 meters and I can find out that 5 kgs, which is converted into grams, this is the weight that is for a cotton sliver of 1000 meters. So it will weigh 5000 grams. So when I divide this by density of cotton, that is 1.54, I get 3246 cc, that is the volume of cotton for this particular length of sliver. Similarly, if I were to calculate for polyester, it would be 3731. As you can see, the volume has increased. Lower the density, density is 1.34, lower is the density, so you find that the volume has increased. Same goes for acrylic, which shows a volume of 4237, further increased because the density is just 1.18. So when I divide by 1.18 here, I would get the answer as 4237. We must keep in mind that the linear density is 5 in all the three cases. Therefore, a sliver made of fibers with low density must be made a little finer. So now we realize that if I am going to use a lower density material, it is going to be bulkier. So I must try and make it a little bit finer. That means the linear density should be lowered so that the bulk of all the component slivers is uniform, which will ensure an uniform grip on all the component slivers by the drafting rollers. So having understood this, let us go to the determination of blend proportion. The first case is when both component slivers have the same linear density. How we can calculate the blend proportion of a particular component in the final sliver. So percentage blend of the component would be number of slivers of the component divided by total number of slivers fed multiplied by 100. It's very simple. But in the second case, when both components have different linear densities, in that case, if NA and NB are the number of slivers of component A and B in the feed, and KA and KB are the linear densities of the slivers of the component in kilotex respectively. This linear densities would change in the, it can be an example in the earlier case where we saw that when there are two materials of very different bulks, I might have to change the linear density of the sliver that I'm feeding. And in such a situation, how we can calculate the blend proportion that we'll get. And this is the formula. Blend percentage of component A is equal to Na into Ka, that is the product of number of slivers that we are feeding into the linear density of that particular component, divided by Na into Ka plus Nb into Kb. That means the total that we are taking multiplied by 100. Similarly, for component B, it would be in the numerator, it would be the values for component B. So now let us understand this with a numerical on blending. The problem is, like, if there are two polyester and six viscose rayon slivers of the same count, it is important to know that that all the slivers of the same count are blended on a draw frame with a draft of 8. So this is sort of the first case where that we have just learned that the slivers are of the same linear density, so I do not have to bother with the more complicated formula here. And there is a draft of 8. And we can see that draft of 8 and also the doubling is 8. So whatever sliver is delivered is going to be of the same linear density as each fed sliver. In the second passage, 4 slivers from the first passage are further blended with 2 combed cotton slivers of the same count. Again, we can see the draft and the doubling values. 4 slivers from the first passage and 2 combed slivers. So again, draft and doubling is same. So what is the percentage of polyester, viscose and cotton in the final sliver? So this is a relatively very, very simple problem. So calculating the percentage of polyester and viscose in a delivered sliver of the first passage, how we can calculate? Since the slivers are of same count and the number of doublings is the same as a draft, we need to consider only the number of slivers that we are feeding here. So therefore, polyester in the delivered sliver would be, since we are feeding 2 slivers, 2 divided by 8, which is the number of doublings, multiplied by 100. So polyester component would be around 25% in the output of the first passage of the draw frame. So second, we can calculate for viscose in the same way. It is 6 upon 8 multiplied by 100, which is 75%. So what we see is, in each delivered sliver of the first passage, there is 25% polyester and 75% viscose. So now we go to the calculation of percentage of polyester, viscose and cotton in the delivered sliver of the second passage. That is what is being asked as a question, final question here. So since the slivers are of same count, again the same thing, since the slivers are of the same count and number of doublings the same as a draft, we need to consider only the number of slivers here. But we see here that there are 4 slivers out of 6 slivers. We are feeding 4 slivers from the first passage. So 4 slivers out of 6 slivers fed. Each sliver has 25% polyester. So to calculate percentage of polyester in the final sliver, what we would do is, since we are feeding 4 slivers of the earlier passage, so 4 divided by 6 into 0.25 percentage, which is the percentage which is there in each feed sliver that is coming from the first passage. So you get a percentage of 16.67. Similarly, for viscose in the final sliver, it would be we are again feeding 4 passage which has got viscose component also. So 4 into 0.75, which is the proportion in the feed sliver, divided by 6 into 100 should give me 50% of viscose in the final sliver. About cotton, cotton is only brought into the picture only on the second passage. So we have no component of cotton in the sliver that comes from the first passage. So we can directly calculate that 2 divided by 6, since we are feeding 2 combed slivers here. And we are feeding 6 slivers of this type, of total slivers. So 2 divided by 6 into 100, which would be 33.33%. So once we have understood this problem, we can go on one more, which is almost similar. But the components have changed. Here we see that 2 polyester and 6 viscose rayon slivers of the same count are blended on a draw frame with a draft of 8. In the second passage, 4 slivers from the first are further blended with 200% viscose slivers of the same count with a draft of 6. So what is done here is, in the first passage, polyester and viscose are brought together, and in the draw frame where both draft and number of doublings is same, which is to be noted. And in the second passage, 4 slivers of the first passage and 2 more slivers of 100% viscose again. In the earlier problem we saw, we had fed cotton here. Here we are again feeding viscose only, just like the first passage. but only two slivers of 100%. And here again, we should note that it is only six doublings, four plus two here, six doublings, and the draft is also six. So you have been asked what is the percentage of viscose in the final sliver. So we just want to know the percentage of viscose. So similarly, as we saw in the earlier problem, we calculate the percentage of polyester and viscose in the delivered sliver of the first passage. So we have already mentioned draft and doubling is same. So we just have to use this formula. Percentage of polyester in delivered sliver is 2 upon 8 into 100, which is 25, just like before. Percentage viscose is 75%. So that means in each delivered sliver of first passage, there is 25% polyester and 75% viscose. So going to the second part of the problem, we have to calculate the percentage of viscose in a delivered sliver of the second passage, that is the final sliver. Since the slivers are of same count again and doublings are same, we consider only the number of slivers. So there are four slivers having 75% viscose, and we are also feeding two slivers of 100% viscose at the feed of the final passage. So what we do is percentage viscose in the final sliver due to the blended sliver that is being fed here would be as calculated earlier. Four of the feed slivers contains around 75% of viscose. So we consider that 4 into 0.75 divided by 6 into 100, which is 50% coming from the first passage. And plus now we are on the second passage, we are also feeding two slivers of 100% viscose. So percentage viscose in the final sliver due to these two viscose slivers fed is 2 by 6 into 100, which is 33%. So therefore, total percentage of viscose in the final sliver would be 50 plus 33, that is 83.33%. And if you note that this is the total that is there for viscose, if you calculate for polyester, you would find that it would be 100 minus 83. So the total component percentage what is there, when you add it up, you should see to it that you get a final answer of 100 to be sure that your calculations are correct. So let us see how do we actually select a blend, and why do we select a certain blend. So when two or more components are brought together, each of the components shall contribute characteristics that are advantageous as well as some disadvantageous characteristics it will bring in for the to the application of the final yarn. So depending on their blend proportions, each component shall have a smaller or a greater advantage. So the amount of fiber that you have used for a particular making of the yarn, so the proportion of it will actually bring in certain properties. If the proportion is more, it will bring more of those characteristics into the final yarn. So it will have a greater influence, more the proportion of any particular component that we might consider. So we can understand that if the properties of the fiber as well as the yarn property requirements, if we already know both of them, if we know what fibers are available with us, their properties, and if we also know that what kind of yarn we are supposed to produce for our final application, then we can match them and have a best possible proportion, which will give me the satisfied result in my final yarn. So this is one small chart showing the different fibers, polyester, viscose, modal, and acrylic nitrile pack. So, which is an acrylic fiber. So, if we see the properties, these properties are shown here, and they are shown as they are highly favorable or medium or low. That means, for example, we see strength-wise, polyester is very good. It will bring in strength properties to the blend if this is this proportion of polyester is this component is added. Whereas in case of viscose, we see that it is it will bring in poor, it is disadvantageous to the blend. And modal and your acrylic fibers would be moderately good. So similarly, when you see all these properties, we can know that polyester has got a strong point in case of dry strength, wet strength, then form stability, crease resistance, thermal set ability, that is pleating, and washability, as well as resistance to rotting. So these are the positive points that this polyester shall bring into the blend. Whereas in case of pill resistance, it is quite poor, as well as water absorption, it is poor. So if you are looking for water absorption properties in your final yarn, you will have to use less proportion of polyester. That is what it is we are trying to analyze. Similarly, with viscose, when you see most of the properties are poor, except that pill resistance is good and water absorption is good, and you can say that dyeing behavior is good. So almost if you have this kind of a blend, say polyester and viscose, you can see the negatives are being compensated in this case by viscose. If polyester is there and you blend with viscose, you might get a blend proportion where almost most of the positive points are polyester are taken, and the positive points of viscose where polyester would lack, it would compensate for those particular properties. So now we look at a chart where it is only polyester and viscose that is blended. On the x-axis, you see viscose is zero in the beginning and you go on increasing up to 100%. And polyester is 100% in the beginning and you go on reducing the polyester. So these first two points give you adequate properties in appearance as well as fabric feel. The third one is recovery from crease. So we know that polyester has got a good recovery, so it will bring in adequate properties. But as you go on increasing the viscose component, it starts becoming poorer, this particular property. Then you go to the next point, that is recovery from creasing. We see that recovery from creasing when polyester is at 100%, it is the best. If you go on reducing polyester and go on increasing viscose component, then you see that this particular crease recovery property goes on reducing, and as you go on increasing viscose proportion further beyond 50% over here, you see that the crease recovery becomes poor. So similarly, we can see the other properties where polyester brings in good properties of itself, that is retention of iron decreases, then resistance to heat and shrinkage resistance to a certain extent, which are the positive points. So if you want these properties in your final yarn, if you know that, then you will go for a higher proportion of polyester when you as compared to viscose. But if you're not bothered about these properties, but if you want certain other properties that you want, like for example moisture absorption, then you will go for a higher viscose component in your final yarn. So the following blends are very common with man-made fibers. For polyester and cotton, it is 85-15, 65-35, 67-33, 50-50 and 45-55. For polyester modal, it is 65-35. Polyester viscose, it is 67-33. And acrylic cotton would be 85-15, 70-30 and 50-50. So now let us see, in case we have 6 doubling and 8 doubling, then what are the various blend proportion I can expect if I keep on adding one more sliver of each component, and see what kind of blend proportions I can expect. So when the feed slivers are 6 and the component sliver are of the same linear density, which is a very important point to be noted here, that each component is of the same linear density. So with increasing number of one component from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5, the blend proportions will be 17, 83, 33, 67, 50, 50 when there are 6 slivers fed and each component is 3, 3 each. So the blend proportion, the final sliver would be 50, 50. Then 67, 33 and 17, 83 respectively. Similarly, when you see the doubling of 8 and you increase one particular component from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 and 6 and 7, the blend proportions will be 12.5 is to 87.5, 25, 75, 37.5, 62.5, 50, 50. This 50, 50 comes when you are feeding 4 slivers of each component. Then again, 62.5, 37 is to 37.5, 75, 25 and 87.5 is to 12.5 respectively. So these are the various blend proportions that you can expect. Of course, you can change the linear density of the sliver and have any kind of blend proportion that you want. But if you are having the same linear density, which is easier to handle, then in that case, these are the proportions that you can expect in your final sliver. So we come to the next topic, that is arrangement of the slivers in the creel. Now we have also seen homogeneity is very important in case of the final sliver. Otherwise, that same trend is repeated or rather carried forward right up to the yarn. And part yarn would be of some one particular component and the other part would exhibit some different properties because of the other component. So we need to see that the homogeneity of the final sliver that we produce is good enough. So how do we ensure that, or rather, can we do something about it? So let us see some examples here. The sliver of polyester and cotton in a PC blend of 6733. In a 6733 blend, if we are going to feed, say, 6 slivers, so 4 slivers would be of polyester and 2 slivers of cotton. So how do we arrange them in the creel? So we see this kind of an arrangement can be done, where polyester, then 1 cotton, then 2 polyester and cotton and polyester. So that what we are doing basically is 2 cotton slivers, we are adjusting them in between 2 polyester slivers on either side. But here there is a slight problem. Here the cotton slivers are placed in between the polyester slivers, but what happens is if the web tensions are reduced, suppose in your web that is coming out from the front roller, and you tend to reduce the web tension so that you do not want to exert a lot of stretch in the web, then in that such a case what will happen is the cotton, because of lower tensions that are applied there, it will try to retract like a spring, it will try to go back to its original position. Then it will it retracts more than the polyester component, and on delivery the cotton slivers that we have fed will in the web, it will form a wavy pattern in the web, which is known as a defect, which is known as a cockling. So to take care of that, what we can do is we put the cotton slivers at the edge and put all the 4 polyester slivers in the center. So how does this help to avoid cockling? The second kind of arrangement is adopted, where the cotton slivers have to travel a longer distance. Now we can imagine cotton being at the edge, and if the trumpet is in the center somewhere here, it is placed in the center, then cotton will have to travel a larger distance as compared to polyester to come to the trumpet, which is centrally placed. So because of the larger distance it has to travel, even if your web tensions are slightly lower, the cockling effect, that is a wavy pattern formation of the cotton slivers, would be reduced. So now we come to a 50-50% blend, where there are say 3 slivers of polyester and 3 slivers of cotton. So this is very simple. We can alternately just arrange them and we get a very good homogeneous mixture. Then we come to a blend where we have 33-67 blend, where we have less of polyester and more of cotton. So one of the arrangements that could be, it could be like this: polyester is put in the center, all the cottons are put at the side. But to get a better blending, what we can also do is we place these polyester slivers in between the cotton over here. You just take this and put them here as an arrangement. Can be separated and placed in between the cotton for a better dispersion and blend. So we can see we can have this kind of an arrangement when it is 2 polyester and 4 cotton. So you place them like this, so you get try to get a better homogeneity. So now we come to the topic where there are processing problems due to machine and atmospheric condition. There will be processing problem due to the fiber, and we'll discuss these problems and what can be really done about it. So any kind of processing problem leads to stoppages of the machine, resulting in the loss in production and an increase in the load of the operator. So what we need to do is we need to really there is a mistake here, just add loss, production loss over here. So stoppages lead to production losses and an increase in the load of the operator. So this is a very important point where we need to understand the processing problems, and if we understand the problems, we might be able to take appropriate action to fix it. So poor condition of the roller, we know that if there are cracks and grooves on the surface, it will lead to a lot of variability in your sliver and lots of problems. So this cannot be acceptable, it has to be fixed. Also, too narrow trumpet bore and coiler tube. We have seen earlier in one of the lectures that the trumpet bore has to be of an optimum size depending on the hank of the sliver that we are delivering. And there is a calculation based on this. So you cannot have a very narrow or a narrow trumpet bore or a coiler tube, which will lead to blockage problems. Then eccentric roller problem we have discussed in detail in one of the lectures. The next is that humidity. Suppose humidity conditions change in the atmosphere, then also there will be problems during processing. So optimum humidity levels are required for satisfactory running. Since the different fibers will react or behave differently with the different humidity levels in the atmosphere. So too low humidity leads to static generation, leading to roller lapping. Also fluff generation due to low cohesion between fibers and stoppages. So too low humidity will lead to static charges on the material, and they will try to stick to the machine parts, leading to maybe roller lapping. Also, if the humidity is low, the fibers will have lesser cohesion between them, and a lot of fluff generation is seen. But at the same time, if the humidity is too high, it also leads to fiber sticking to the machine parts, because the fiber will try to absorb moisture from the atmosphere. If the fiber, of course, if the fiber that you're processing is hygroscopic in nature, something like cotton, then it will absorb moisture, and again it will lead to similar sticking problems to the machine parts. So one cannot have too low a humidity or too high a humidity. Depending on the fiber that you're processing, you'll have to have optimum humidity levels for satisfactory running. So coming to other problems which are related to fiber, let us see them one by one. In case of cotton, honeydew is one of the problems. Honeydew is a sticky liquid secreted by insects as they feed on the plant, cotton plant. So this liquid may be there in the cotton that is used, that we are going to take for processing. Then what will happen is this sticky liquid will stick to the spinning elements, resulting in deterioration in yarn characteristics and increase in the ends down, increase in, that is, breakages. So the second problem with man-made fibers, or the ones which require spin finish, is that the spin finish might be of poor quality or might be inadequate or less, so which will lead to static generation and therefore sticking of the rollers due to the static generation, leading to roller lapping, drafting problems, splitting tendency of the web, blockages at the trumpet, and also thermal damage. So how does this thermal damage, all others is very clear, I guess. Only thermal damage, how it will happen if the spin finish is inadequate, that we shall discuss. Inadequate spin finish leads to high friction, and therefore a lot of frictional heat is generated. If the roller temperatures reach 80 degrees, then the viscosity of the spin finish also tends to change. So also when the machine stops, this heat generated will lead to damaging of the fibers that are there in between the nib. So it's a very serious damage, because even a 2 cm damage in the sliver will give a yarn of 5 to 50 meters damaged yarn that will show up only after dyeing. So spin finish, if it is inadequate or if it is of poor quality, then you will have such problems in your during your processing. Too fine fibers are we are processing, that then it will lead to a lot of roller lapping. We need to really be careful when we are processing fine fibers. Also, if the crimp in the material, in case of man-made fiber especially, if it is too low or too high, then also it creates a problem, because the fiber crimp makes the fiber behave like a spring. Let us imagine the fiber to be like a spring. Then the fiber, as soon as it is stretched during processing, say in the drafting system, it will lead to disturbances, because it will try to retract once it is stretched, and it will retract very fast. Retract means it will try to contract and come to its original shape and size, just like a spring, and it will create disturbances during drafting. Crimp is needed while carding for the formation of web. Now, why do we go for applying any kind of crimp? That's because in case of carding, if the fibers are smooth and there is no crimp in the fibers, then interlocking of the fibers does not take place, and also formation of web on card will become very difficult. So crimp is something that is required up to the carding stage, but once it comes on the drafting stage in on draw frame, it starts becoming a nuisance during drafting. So normally semi-permanent crimp is given to the fiber that shall last only till the end of the carding stage. Once it comes out of the carding stage, this semi-permanent crimp will just go out of the fiber, and processing on draw frame becomes easier, and you'll get a better quality sliver at the draw frame. Also, same time, high bulk, if it is there, such fibers are also very difficult to process, and care needs to be taken. If the moisture content is low, also it creates problems. We have seen if moisture content is low, it leads to static generation. Too much variation in sliver mass. If there is a variation, you have set a trumpet for a particular linear density of sliver, and there is too much variation, then it may lead to trumpet blockages. So also, if there is a lot of short fibers in your material, then especially let us first see length less than 12 mm is called as generally termed as short fibers, and if that proportion in your feed sliver is too much for the short fibers, then we see that such fibers do not contribute to the strength and it's of no use to us. It will only contribute to the weight of the final yarn, but at the same time it will create a lot of problems during drafting, which we have seen under the lecture drafting waves. Short fibers will then, if there are too many, they all will be behaving like floating fibers without any direction, and they will add to the drafting wave or the defect of thick and thin places in your output sliver. So now we come to the processing problems due to the process itself. So if the settings are inappropriate, that is, you have, for example, in the break draft zone, that is a back zone, we have applied a wide setting or a narrow setting. So narrow setting leads to high drafting forces. This we have also discussed in the earlier lecture of ours, drafting forces. And if the setting is too wide, then gripping of the long fibers if it's narrow, then long fibers, there's another problem that the rollers will grip them on both the sides and they may damage the longer ones. But at the same time, the setting is too wide, that also leads to the drafting wave. We've seen if the setting is too wide, all the fibers will behave like floating fibers, including the longer ones, and too wide a setting is also not advisable. So inappropriate setting will lead to a lot of processing problems. High speed also, if the speed is too high during processing, then it leads to thermal damage because it will lead to a lot of generation of heat. And we have seen in the earlier slide a generation of heat, how it damages the fibers, especially the thermoplastic fibers if we are going to process them. So while running thermoplastic fibers, the machine speeds must be reduced. Too much web spreading also leads to roller lapping. So if the web that is spread over a larger width when it is coming out of the drafting system, it will lead to roller lapping. Also, accumulation of fibrous dust in various places like trumpet will lead to processing problems and it will give you irregular output sliver. So with all these problems that we have seen, once you know the problem, you can maybe fix it accordingly. And if you are aware of the problem beforehand, say you know you are going to process fine fibers, you know you are going to process a high bulk fiber, so we can take precautions earlier, at the earlier stages, and we will know how to tackle them. So understanding of the problems that we might face during processing is very important. Then we will be able to find the remedies for each one of them. So with this, we end today's lecture. Thank you.